Hello, and welcome to Devlog 11. I'm Ian Lindsay from Game Digits, and this time I'll be going through the overall game design, the game master, and the game flow. So for the game design, let's start with this fundamental question. Why do people play games? It's quite a deep question, but a lot of it has got to do with intrinsic and extrinsic motivators. Okay, some of you will be thinking, what on earth are you talking about, Ian? Well, let me explain. So intrinsic motivators are self-fulfilling tasks, such as learning skills or exploring. We simply do them because we enjoy doing them. These are things like personal challenges, improving yourself and blind curiosity, things that you give yourself a little pat on the back when you do something well. On the flip side, we have extrinsic motivators. These are external rewards, such as achievements, money and fame. Ultimately, they make us feel good because we feel validated for what we've done. So these include achievements and praise, receiving something of worth, exclusivity, and especially for games, winning competitively. Okay, some of you might be thinking, hey, these are just fancy words. How do these really work in a game? Well, I think the best way would be to play a game.
Let's play Spot the Trinsic with your host, Ian Lindsay.
Okay, so let's go through a few games and see if we can spot the intrinsic and extrinsic motivators.
Intrinsic motivator. Extrinsic reward. Intrinsic motivator. Intrinsic motivator. Extrinsic reward.
Games are full of these motivators, and it's the main reason why people play them. The more you can identify these and understand what is motivating the player to play your game, the more you can strengthen these experiences and make it more enjoyable for them to play. On the flip side, if you're struggling to find these motivators in your game, then it could be that there aren't any, and it would be a great benefit to rethink your design and add some of these motivators in. Okay, so we can work out what motivates people, but where do you start? A lot of games change and mutate during development. They are complex things and very difficult to design upfront. Some developers start with a mechanic. No, not that kind of mechanic. Some developers start with a story or an idea, something they've been thinking about and have an image in their mind. But no matter how it starts, there's generally an evolutionary process which takes a small idea or mechanic and turns it into a full game. However, as many indie developers will tell you, it's very easy to fail during this step. I like to use what I call guided evolution. This is where rules and experience and processes steer the game's design to give more insights into what makes the most enjoyable game. And I will be explaining more of these in the Devlog series. Currently, we can see that intrinsic and extrinsic motivators are going to play quite a key part in the game design. Another good design rule is to always have a clear objective. It's important that the player has a clear goal to achieve, and the journey is made as enjoyable as possible. It's also important to know what genre your game is going to be, and this will change the type of rules that are used in the evolutionary stage. For this game, I had three different ideas with different genres. I had a story-based idea, I had a sandbox idea, and I had an escape room slash puzzle idea. I then did some market research to find which idea that people liked the most, and this led me down a story-based genre. With this in mind, I can now put together the overall game structure. First of all, there is long-term objective, which is an extrinsic motivator and will carry a reward. Within this, I can have story progression sections, which are an intrinsic motivator. Within these sections, I can have short-term goals, which have extrinsic rewards. And finally, within these goals, I have the actual game tasks that the player will perform, and these will have intrinsic motivators. However, the important part is that the player always has motivation throughout the game and has a clear objective and an engaging story to progress through. So ultimately, I can take this game structure and the vertical slice I already have, or as I like to call it, a posh prototype, then apply this game structure around it with a coherent and interesting story, paying close attention to what is motivating the player at every stage. It's also good to have a mix of intrinsic and extrinsic motivators along the way. But more on that in future devlogs. One question I get asked quite a lot is how do you structure a full game in Unity? Usually there's just one scene with a prototype or a fleshed out level, and it needs a structure around it to organise the flow of the game, such as the menus or a save system. There are several ways of doing this. However, I've used this method on every game I've published, and it gives you a lot of benefits. So you create a game master scene, and this has just one object at the root. There are no lights or cameras, just this one object, and it's called Game Master. You can then create a Game Master script and allow access to its instance from any other script using this code shown on the screen. In the awake function, you can then assign the instance and call the don't destroy on load function. This will keep the game master object around, even when loading different scenes. So in this game, the game master scene is loaded first, and it has code in the game master script to load in the first scene. In this case, it's the intro scene. As the game master script is not destroyed when the intro scene is loaded, the intro scene then calls the game master instance to then load in the next scene, which in this case is the home scene, and in turn the home scene then calls the game master to load the save selection scene. Ultimately, the game master script is responsible for loading in the scenes, and as it's persistent all of the time, it means that other data can be handled by the game master too. Considering you can have child objects attached to the game master, you can then add other persistent data or managers you want to exist throughout the game. For example, I have an object that holds the player data.
Game Master 2.
Well, thank you for watching Devlog 11. As always, there's just one thing left to do.
Quit that. Quit messing around. I'm not into that. This is my personal bubble. You're all up in it.
Now with that out the way, see you in Devlog 12.